Columbus, Ohio is the site for the 5th annual Magic the Gathering U.S. National Championships. Competitors are vying for a purse of $58,000 and one of four coveted slots to represent the U.S. team at this year's World Championships.
Nationals is the hardest tournament in the world every year. This is like the coming out party for all the people that we've never heard of.
There's so many great players that come here and play. You know, there's, what, 200 people in the Nationals. So you work hard.
You get the idea of what the day's going to be like from what's called these meat grinder tournaments. They want to see what came out on top, what decks consistently were doing well, and that forms a lot of the metagame for the next day.
I think that the Wrath Cycle is probably the most interesting draft format that we've used so far.
Tempest Stronghold Exodus draft. I think that black took a big hit.
In Tempest, I think it's interesting that green is usually weak, except, interestingly enough, in combination with blue.
When it was just Tempest Stronghold, I like to get, you know, four or five counter magic. Now, I think my mana curve has increased as far as the creatures I'm casting.
The addition of Exodus has just sent the color of white over the top.
I've gotten like a total, like, over the last 3 days, like 8 hours sleep or something like that.
I had barely any sleep, and now I'm gonna pay for it.
Matt Lindy made it to the finals, who's my little boy. He's gotta be the favorite over me.
But if I play Mike, I think I have a pretty good shot. I don't know, it's challenging to play against like some of the best people in the world.
It's an experience that can't be described. You have to live it for yourself. So I'll probably just tell my friends to try their best to try to make it to Nationals next year.
It's been an exceptional year for American players. Unlike previous years, they've taken home the top prize in every major pro tournament. The Windy City, Chicago, welcomed the first pro tour featuring the extended constructed format. Newcomer Randy Bueller made a splash debut, okay, defeating veteran competitor,
oh my God,
David Mills. A transatlantic hop to Mainz, Germany was the tour's next stop, where Pro Tour regular Matt Place defeated Stephen O'Mahony Schwartz in a Tempest-only Rochester draft. Los Angeles was a chance for another veteran player to take home a victory as King of the Qualifiers David Price defeated Ben Rubin in a Tempest-only constructed format. Then the road led to New York City, where yet another Pro Tour staple, Jon Finkel, proved his mastery of Tempest Stronghold Booster Draft by defeating Dominic Krapischitz. With 6 rounds of Tempest Stronghold Exodus Booster Draft and 6 rounds of standard constructed play, 148 competitors played over 2 grueling days of competition to determine who would make one of the top 8 slots to advance to the finals. It was no surprise that the list of finalists held many of the game's top names. The top seed, from Virginia, Mike Long. From New York, David Price. Also from Virginia, Peter Lyer. From California, Bryce Currents. New Jersey boy, Jon Finkel. From Maryland, Matt Lindy. Floridian, Andrew Pacifico. And also from California, Ryan Kelly. With 3 Pro Tour champions, 1 Junior Super Series champion, and 2 former U.S. team members among the ranks, the Final 8 is a very impressive collection of players. 7th seed Andrew Pacifico discovered Magic by chance.
The reason I got started in Magic is because I used to play video games a while back, and I went into a video game store, and I saw the Magic packs. And I was like, hey, what's this? That's how it started. Some of my favorite cards are probably Curse Scroll and Ball Lightning. Curse Scroll is an artifact. It's a 1 casting cost artifact that has permanent damage, and it's really cool. Ball Lightning is really quick damage. It's 3 casting costs for 6 damage, and it's just, it helps the speed in the deck. Nationals has been great. There's a lot of competition, a lot of friends, you meet a lot of new people.
Round 1's first matchup was Pacifico versus Price. Both players had variations of slide decks. The match went lightning fast. In the end, experience won out as David Price, considered by many to be the premier slide player, took the match 3-0. The second match paired Peter Lyer with newcomer Matt Lindy. The deck pairing was not in Lyer's favor, though, as he was forced to play his prosperous Bloom deck against its nemesis, the White Weenie deck. Lyer put up a good fight, but was taken down by Lindy 3-1. The third matchup featured Bryce Currens and Jon Finkel. Here's Bryce.
This is actually the first time I finished top 8 of any tournament, any major tournament, national championships, pro tour. It's real important for me to gain some recognition, not only, you know, in the community, but for myself, because I really want to have a chance. It would be my first world championship. You get a chance to play on the national team at that tournament is something I would really look forward to. I've had, you know, nothing but fun for the last 4 years playing this hobby. I hope that I am able to keep playing Magic, you know, far, far into the future. I enjoy the company of everyone else here on the Pro Tour, of all the people that show up, you know, even locally at my own tournaments in Los Angeles. So I can't imagine having more fun at this point in my life.
The two had met earlier, where Currens' mono green deck had nearly defeated Finkel's mono blue. History would not repeat itself, as Finkel easily won the match 3-0. The final matchup paired Pro Tour Paris champ Mike Long against the other newcomer in the top 8, Ryan Kelly. Playing the same prosperous Bloom deck as his teammate Peter Lyer, Long had better luck getting off his combo. He managed to defeat Ryan's mono green deck 3-1. In a modified double elimination tournament, players are not eliminated until they've suffered 2 losses. This means that all 8 players will advance to the second round. In the consolation bracket, 4 competitors fought for the remaining slots on the U.S. team. A second loss eliminates them from the tournament. Peter Lyer, 95 U.S. national team member, was paired against Andrew Pacifico. Lyer is no stranger to tournament-level play.
My play style, aggressive, and I'm very into the mental aspect of the game. I believe that sometimes the cards you draw just can't win on their own. And sometimes if you can get into your opponent's head, that can influence the game. Usually I like to play an aggressive deck, one that doesn't give my opponent much chance to recover. For this particular tournament, I decreased the amount of counter magic I like to draft. I include a number of 5 casters now, as before I'd play the smaller, faster creatures. It's addictive. The collectability attracts some people. The competition attracts some people. I think that's why it attracts a wide array of people, and that everyone can enjoy.
Peter Lyer was defeated 3-0. In the other consolation match, Bryce Currens played against Ryan Kelly. Ryan considers himself a player who doesn't create waves, but just likes to have fun.
The thing that I like about Magic, I mean, it's a fun game. You can get away from, like, regular life. Just, like, sometimes in summer you're bored, you don't have anything to do. You could always go play Magic somewhere or something.
Well, this is my new favorite card. It's from Exodus. It's called Spike Weaver. It's a green card. And I recommend it. It's a big card, I guess. I mean, in the deck that I played in, it works really well. Every big tournament I've played in, I've done all right, or I've scrubbed out. I've never, like, made any good amounts of money or anything. So I just, hopefully, just, like, keep on qualifying and maybe make money one day. But I'm having fun. Just keep enough money to maintain Magic and have a good time and go travel and stuff. So that's what I'm just hoping to do, basically.
The difference in the match came down to Currens' sideboard. Currens won the match 3-0.
In the first semifinal are 2 fast decks, 1 red, 1 white. Dave Price is playing his signature deck, Dead Guy Red. Original Sly focused on mana curve and card flexibility, but Price's deck is simply about doing 20 points of damage. It contains 4 copies of the best cheap red creatures and removal spells, and it has some staying power with Curse Scroll and Hammer of Bogardon.
As good as Dead Guy Red and its designer are, this style is probably the most heavily tested concept in contemporary Magic. Newcomer Matt Linney's deck is classic White Weenie. It has two primary themes: an early rush of quick, efficient creatures backed up by Imperial Armor, and a mid-game reset or lock with Cataclysm. Lindy's deck has seven perfect sideboard cards, and it is prepared for a top 8 field that includes two Prosperous Bloom decks. His deck is fast, flexible, and deadly, and he's got a great chance in this top 4 playoff. Mono Red on Mono White is a classic matchup. Lindy has the advantage, and his Imperial Armor, Encores, and Pro Red creatures are a nightmare for Price's deck. Price's one chance is Cursed Scroll. Without it, he can't remove most of Lindy's creatures, and his offense will be paralyzed. But Price is known as the King of Beatdown, and is famous for overcoming adversity.
I love the game. It continually challenges me. You know, each big tournament, there's different cards that we're allowed to use. So you know, it changes rapidly. So you have to keep on your toes.
Well, this one's a mountain. I think it's the best land in the game. But I think in general, all the non-basic lands, they tend to slow down your deck. They usually have drawbacks, and they tend to screw up your game a little bit. But this basic lands allow for the most speed when you're playing your deck. Dwarven Miner. I actually have a few in my sideboard. You can use it to destroy non-basic lands. It's a pretty powerful card. Hopefully, I'll make the Nationals team. But in the event that I don't, I'm still going to be at Worlds. I'm gonna be there, trying to do well.
We pick up the action as Dave Price and Matt Lindy begin game two.
Also a good choice.
Possibly.
He's got a Priest, a Nomad Encore, a Imperial Armor, and a Sultari Monk. And a Worm? Is that a Worm?
No, he does not have anti-red cards in his sideboard.
Sultari Visionary. Price also has a very good draw. Jackal Pup, two Jackal Pups, so this two Mogfanax, and Ball Lightning.
It's a very good draw for Dave.
Yeah, they both have good
Lindy
draws.
Lindy has no anti-red.
No, he does, but he has Nomad Encore and Priest.
Oh, he does have a Priest.
Yeah, the question is, will he wait to play that guy?
But he plays a Nomad. Yeah, the Nomad's going to...
Plays it immediately. He should probably wait.
The Nomad is not going to make it to the next turn because Dave's going to cast the Fanatic and the Pup. Or he might just Fanatic the Nomad right now, which is what's probably going to happen.
Yeah. Kaboom.
Yep, Pup comes over. What do you think about playing the Nomad before the Priest?
I think it was a poor play. I think looking at his hand, he has just Shadows, and the Nomad backed up by the Priest is an infinite damage sink against all the red creatures.
I mean, if you had another Encore in your hand, I can see it being a decision.
Priest. Now it's just a race, but I don't think that the Armor can race the hand that... If Price draws one more mountain, he'll be able to outrun Armored Priest easily. Crunch. Lindy goes down to 14, Price still at 20. What's Price going to play here? He plays. Now, will he play the Scroll or hang back with Shocks?
That's a tough call. A lot of people say that against White Weenie decks, you shouldn't play the Scroll until you can use it. Dave's been...
Oh, he drew Spirit Link. Oh, wow.
Oh my boy. That was an unbelievable draw.
Yeah, absolutely perfect draw. Armor up the Priest, Spirit Link it.
The thing is, if Dave draws a mountain, he's dead.
Yeah, if Dave does draw a mountain, he can kill him right now. Actually, no, I think he'll be one life short of doing it.
No, he's not. He comes over for...
Oh, he links right now.
Oh, he links him right now. That's probably the safer way to do things.
Okay, he's playing Warrior Encore.
Oh, is that a Warrior Encore?
No,
that's
white
a White Knight.
Knight.
Now okay, Dave so has to shock the Knight.
The White Knight. Draw a mountain right here. Can Dave win this game if he draws a mountain right here?
No, it only does 11. And that's not
Iron
a mountain.
Orcs.
So Dave Price, I know for a fact, has never faced this before. This is the kind of thing that if I brought it up to him, he would tell me I was ridiculous. There's no way that's going to happen. No one would do this.
Spirit-linked Armored Priest.
This is unreal. This is the mono-red nightmare.
Armor!
Oh,
wham!
Destroy
Game
you.
Five. It's pretty hard to race.
Well,
drain life for five every turn. Drain for five.
This is pretty unbelievable.
Is there anything that Dave can do? Can he outrace it? Is it possible? Draw a mountain right here? No, that's a wasteland.
Dave could, in theory, outrace it. He's doing more damage than Lindy's gaining, right? I mean, he could outrace it if he gets the mountain.
He's going to get him down
next
to...
Next turn, then he takes...
He gets him down to 9, then he goes back to 14.
He gains 6, yeah. No, he gains 6 next turn.
Oh, he gains 6 next turn. Well...
And then 7, and it's
then
over.
Then I don't think the math works out then in that case.
Wow, Spirit Link, 1 of 2. I could draw another armor or another Spirit Link. A very ineffective Curse Scroll.
Go ahead.
Draws. Mash. We asked Matt Lindy about the deck building process.
You have to take so many things into consideration, like what the field is. You have to beat a deck to beat what other people are playing. It's not just like what cards work well together and everything. Me and my friend worked on the deck for like 4 hours to fine tune it.
Wow, he can get him to 1 if he draws.
Mountain?
Another That's not line. A mountain. So that's not going to do it.
That
the priest
be
is still not big enough to kill him, right?
Yeah, it is. Next turn it comes through for 7.
6. Oh, 7?
Yeah, he's got 4
cards.
Oh,
you're right.
Now.
Okay. Yep, that's game then.
Wow.
Oh, maybe Lindy will disenchant the scroll.
Probably not. Let's see. Obviously, he should not, but that would give Price 1 more turn.
If he doesn't. So that's the game.
Crank. Tithe.
Tithe to go larger.
Make it bigger. That's game. Okay, so Lindy goes up 2-0. The second semifinal is Control versus Combo. Who can be surprised that Mike Long chose to pursue his third U.S. team berth with the deck that made him famous, Prosperous Bloom? The goal of the deck is to cast a huge drain life using the mana from Cadaverous Bloom. The deck is given explosive speed by squandered resources and natural balance, and its combos are stitched together with Vampiric Tutor and Impulse. Prosperous Bloom has had its ups and downs in standard play, but if anyone can make it work here, it is Mike Long. Current Pro Player of the Year leader Jon Finkel is playing a mono-blue design he has dubbed Forbidian. Finkel's deck combines the card drawing of Ophidian with the buyback Exodus counterspell Forbid. The remainder of the deck is vintage mono-blue with 9 buybacks and the blue bounce arsenal of Manowar and Tradewind Rider. Forbid has made this deck a real contender, and in the hands of Jon Finkel, it will be operating at peak efficiency. This second round match pits two Pro Tour greats against each other in a contest of wits and tactics. Mono Blue isn't great against Prosperous Bloom to begin with, and Finkel's version is even weaker because it lacks any real offense. This matchup favors Long, but you can never factor out Finkel, regarded by many as the world's best player.
Mike Long is playing the Cadaverous Bloom Drain Life Prosperity deck, which he, of course, is one of the people who played it at the premier tournament for it, which was Pro Tour Paris, which he was the winner of. Jon Finkel is playing a mono blue deck, which has been dubbed Forbidian. It's a creature-based control deck, attempting to abuse the Ophidian Forbid combo. Forbid being a buyback counterspell where buyback cost is discarding cards from your hand. So now Finkel has to decide, is he going to blow a Whispers?
So Long lost an opportunity to meditate. Let's take a closer look at Jon Finkel.
I'll be happy if I end up making the U.S. national team. Last year, I made top 8 and didn't make the team, so, you know, obviously it would not be very fun for it to happen again this year. Well, I suppose my favorite card would be a card named Ophidian. It's a blue creature, and I like it because instead of damaging your opponent, it lets you draw cards. I tend to play more control-oriented decks which are more designed to gain control of the game and then attempt to kill my opponent rather than trying to kill my opponent before he can gain control of the game. I'm hoping that the game will continue to grow as it has. A lot of people like games where you're not tested based on like the strength of your arm or how fast you can run, but a game which has to do with, you know, how fast you can think and how well you can, you know, react mentally to different situations.
So Finkel's hand is, lands are piling up in his hand.
So I think Finkel is going to attempt to get to the 6 mana Whisper.
Too bad.
Which of course would be
Ophidian.
If Long had Final Fortune.
Does he play the Ophidian? He does.
Has to. You have to go for the Ophidian. Now, I think the main reason why it's important is Finkel knows that if Long had a Pyroblast for the Ophidian, Finkel could then Hydroblast it.
Yeah.
Now, this is an interesting situation where if Long just decides to act like Finkel doesn't have counters, he'd be right, and Finkel could be in trouble.
What could he do?
And then he can still meditate safely, although every hit with an Ophidian's bad at this point, but if he just gets a Pyro...
That seems like that would be insane, though.
What is... Is Finkel on his upkeep here?
Yeah, Finkel's untapped. Just thinking about Hydroblast and the Ophidian. What's going on? Oh, okay.
I think Long's going to abeyance him.
Okay, so he can't draw a card with Ophidian. Take one.
Tings.
Bam.
This is pretty interesting. Finkel just needs Long to not get a squandered in his next couple cards, and then Finkel can really be in control, I think.
Yeah, as soon as Finkel gets a counterspell in hand, I'd imagine his comfort in this match would increase dramatically. Gets Prosperity, Swamp. Actually, is that Power Sink? Impulse? Okay, it's Power Sink. What will he be keeping? It's Impulse.
He kept it.
So for all those people that read the Dojo articles out there, that's how Mike Long impulses.
Still no counterspell, but... Still no counterspell. Finkel, I'm sure, will impulse here to try to get a counter.
As soon as he has
but
a counter.
But maybe he just wants to whisper, I don't know.
No, he's impulsing.
I mean, he does impulse, so...
That was Dancing Scimitar. There's Forbid. Two Forbids. Wow.
So now things are interesting, and this is exactly the thing we said Finkel had to do to win. He has to just get gutsy, cast out Ophidian, and hope for the best, and that's exactly what happened.
Wow, it's practically a lock right here already.
I mean, it's... He still has one scary turn here where he can't Forbid twice, though.
Pyroblast, City of Solitude. A lot of good cards. Which one is it going to be? Can he go Abeyance City?
He does not have a land to go Abeyance City.
Yeah, he may draw one, though.
He may draw one.
What would be the card to keep?
Now he thinks he takes City of Solitude, which I think is probably the right play.
Definitely. You can assume that Finkel has...
So now Finkel's going to have some scary turn coming up right here.
Draw a land?
Oh,
there's a land.
Oh, boy.
Well, it looks like City of Solitude will get into play.
That was really bad for John.
But then again, we'll see. Do you think Mike Long may... Cast Abeyance first, and then
I would imagine
cast Abeyance, and then
imagine
chicken out, and not cast the city if it's countered.
Oh. So I would imagine that Mike Long will cast Abeyance, and John Finkel will forbid it with buyback.
What are the cards he's going to discard here?
Forbid. Buyback.
Hydro and Whispers?
Okay.
Oh, Trade and Rider. Okay, so he does it with Whisper and Trade and Rider. Well, the Trade and Rider apparently did have an impact on the game. Whoa.
Now, will Mike Long cast City of Solitude?
Yeah, this is the big question. Is he going to... Well, he played...
And
yeah,
yes, he will.
He's got guts.
This is really bad.
Boom. Some good. Oh my god. Situation just
unreal.
Like that. Incredible that it got through.
Yeah.
Wow.
Finkel needs to capsize in his next couple cards. Your turn.
That Ophidian's got work to do. Draw.
Island, not gonna do it.
Medallion,
not going to do it.
Wow. Suddenly Finkel's just powerless behind some good again. Meditate?
He has to be... If he wants to meditate, it's very risky. It gives Finkel numerous turns with Ophidian.
If he were to meditate and draw land and squander resources, he could definitely win this turn.
Right, but if he meditates and doesn't draw squander resources, he's in severe trouble.
I think he's doing it anyway. Loop.
So this is all about whether this is
black.
A squandered.
Black. For mana.
Oh, is he casting natural
triple
balance?
Stone rain,
oh, yuck.
Oh, wow.
Okay.
No, it's not devastating. He'll still be all right if he just capsizes because the Sapphire Medallion. So long it's land.
That's probably the right choice.
Yeah, what do you think about casting natural balance?
It's probably the right choice. Meditate's way too risky right now. he were to meditate and did not get a squandered, Finkel gets multiple turns with Whispers and Ophidian going.
It's ugly. So funny how Mono Blue is so powerless against City of Solitude, though.
And that's the point of the card. Yeah. I mean, that's the essence of what it's meant to do. Finkel had that turn. We said that was that's exactly what he didn't need to happen. That's exactly what did happen. His numerous cards, if he has a counterspell or a monolink or one more land or anything, it
he draws Quicksand.
Still no cap size.
Could draw cards.
Sure.
Still no cap size.
Another dime. Whisper with buyback.
Sapphire Redeye. Sure.
Finkel's drawing three cards a turn. How long will it take for him to draw capsize?
Still no capsize.
Draw squandered.
Cadaverous Bloom.
You can just chuck that into play.
The weakness of John Cyborg is really showing this game, I think.
Yeah. Hydro Blast, just don't cut it. So basically this game's over next turn.
Finkel has a turn to draw capsize.
Otherwise, Mike Long draws about 30 cards.
But if he draws a capsize,
Tradewind Rider, or is that Silver Wyvern?
See, discarding the I don't even understand discarding the Tradewind now. Like, if he had a Tradewind out this whole time, this game would be very different also, because now he would be able to bounce.
No Whispers without buyback.
Yeah, very smart. They Whispers without buyback, knowing he's got one turn to go. Ah, he's got his last chance is the Furnace. Does he have enough mana to? Okay, if he draws capsize here, he can capsize without buyback and still be able to forbid.
But
you hadn't already laid land? No, you're right, you're right. Okay, sorry. Something.
An abeyance.
Sure. Which one?
See the capsize. Is it there?
So we need a capsize to make this game interesting.
Mike Long win this match.
Oh, this is actually
one. Medallion.
Another Sapphire Medallion.
Mana in my pool, correct?
Yeah, Finkel knows it's over already.
Meditate. Is that cool?
So I'll certainly be interested to hear from Finkel after this match to see if he thinks it was a mistake.
Three. Yeah, that's true.
Four.
Finkel has a very, very analytical mind for games. It's interesting to walk up and talk to him after a game that you've played. I do that very frequently and talk to him about a situation that may have come up because he's able to dissect a scenario very quickly and tell you what might have been the better play and so on. And it'll be interesting to ask him about this particular situation and see what he was thinking.
Okay, no floating mana except for the green. Just the two green. Squander, my favorite island in the world. Good island.
Mike Long shows us the portal island.
Give me three. Pay another turn. Meditate. So you're probably going to beat me up really bad next turn. Four.
So this game is really over.
Guess what, guys? We get to go through this again. The game of Magic means a great deal to Jon Finkel. We asked him why.
Yeah, I really like the competitiveness of Magic. I mean, there are very few times in like anyone's life where they can be like one of the best in the world at something. So, you know, I'm really glad that, you know, I've had this opportunity.
Well, maybe Long will end this quickly now that it's the match. There's no reason to do any further damage to Jon Finkel's ego at this point.
Good. Game over.
4-6.
I think Finkel, if he kept the Tradewind, just this whole game could go the other way.
Okay, I'm going to empty all these into my mana.
He's
going to
empty the coffers.
Mm-hmm. That's 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12, 14, 16, 18, 20, 22, 24, 26, 28, 30, 32, 34, 36, 38, 40, 42. 42 black mana into my mana pool. Mm-hmm. Cast a drain life upon you.
Okay.
In response. Tap and squander this in response. Pyroblast both of your
creatures.
Whoa, didn't he mana leak?
Good luck to John. I really hope you make the team. is that game?
Okay, so that's the match. Mike Long wins the match 3-1 against Jon Finkel.
Tension filled the third round consolation matches. Winning meant at least $8,000 and a slot on the national team. Losing meant walking away with nothing. David Price played Bryce Currents. Price put up a good fight, winning the first game, but his deck, Dead Guy Red, didn't have a chance against Currents' deck, Stupid Green. Currents won the match 3-1. Jon Finkel versus Andrew Pacifico paired the slow-controlling Forbidian against Pacifico's quick-hitting Sly. It was a back-and-forth battle, ending in the dramatic fifth game where Finkel took the match 3-2.
The final showdown pits Mike Long's Prosperous Bloom against Matt Lindy's White Weenie deck and heavily favors the junior player. Matt Lindy has dispatched several Bloom decks already and has to be feeling confident. Combine 5 main deck enchantment defense with 4 cataclysms and you'll have no trouble seeing why Lindy's deck has the advantage. But Mike Long is a master Bloom player, many say the best, so don't count him out. Lindy has the superior deck, but Long has the experience. This should be quite a match. Matt Lindy is a relative newcomer to the Nationals experience, and he's made it all the way to the finals. We talked to him earlier.
This is my first Nationals, and it was pretty neat to play against like some of the best people. There's no better competition in the world. It's an honor to play in such a high caliber tournament. Well, I played white this tournament, but usually I play blue. It's got fast creatures, and then back it up with like counter spells, and so there's like a balance. It's not all offense, it's not all defense. I try to be aggressive. I don't like sitting back. I like to take the initiative and start attacking them. I think about my moves a lot before I do them because I don't want to make any mistakes. Well, since I did good in this tournament, I get to go to Worlds, so I guess I'm going to be preparing for that for a while. Try to help the U.S. team win the team competition.
Lindy's opening hand is a bunch of 2 casting cost creatures, a tithe, a planes, and 2 Imperial Armors.
It's pretty good.
So Long looks at his hand.
Me neither.
Okay. Swamp, Squander Resources, Vampire Tutor, Emerald Charm, I think. Emerald Charm, a Natural Balance, and some card that's very shiny. Swamp. Main phase, tithe.
Main phase, tithe to avoid a disrupt, maybe?
I guess so.
I'd like to point out that tithe did target Mike Long.
It did.
So now we're going to see some sort of 2-caster.
I think that's a proxy. It
matters
okay,
very little versus Mike what 2-caster it is. He goes for the shadow. In case of Wall of Blossoms.
Yeah, if he checks an armor on that, if he draws a land and armors up, it's going to be hard for Mike Long to race that.
Mike has a very good hand. I don't think it's going to be that hard for him to race it.
Don't cast.
There's a tithe. Which will get him another planes into play, then he'll cast another creature. I don't think this is going to be fast enough. Long's hand is unbelievable.
Yeah, does Long have the entire combo in his hand already? Is he missing Cadaver's Bloom?
He has a Natural Balance, a Vampiric Tutor, a Squandered Resources.
Vampiric Tutor.
Yep.
You'll never guess what I'm going to get.
Gloom? Is he going to tutor for Gloom, Chris?
I don't know. He might just get Cadaverous Bloom. No, he gets Gloom.
He gets some good Gloom.
So Gloom here may just seal the fate. He already has an Emerald Charm, which would kill the Norris and Aura of Silence anyway.
No, I'm ruining the camera ambiance
here. Yeah, Gloom will keep armor off of his back and buy him at least 3 more turns under the shadows.
Where's your card?
Wait, I think this is the card right here.
What? Look, that's harassment. That's harassment.
Okay.
So this is very much looking like Mike Long is going to be
the pen.
U.S. national champion.
So good!
God.
Gloom.
So there's Gloom.
He's done.
All right, Lindy needs some planes fast.
Matt Lindy is someone in a position of just happy to be here, so you can tell he's not very upset at losing, but...
There's one planes.
Soul Warden could come out, but no. I just hit you before. Sorry, I'll leave you around. What am I at? Done.
Does he have everything in his hand right now?
He does not have a Cadaverous Bloom.
And he has Meditate and Contract?
Yeah.
Go ahead.
He doesn't have blue mana right now either. He has a Natural Balance.
Ouch.
He has a Natural Balance.
Okay, Life Tales are what? Long at 10? Lindy
Long
at 20?
Long is not low enough. Lindy can't cast anything in his hand. Long's at eight.
Green
but...
mana.
Green.
Yeah, I think Long is not happy about his four forest, though.
Almost good.
There's a Bance. Bash.
That's every forest in Mike Long's deck. Maybe he'll sack him and forget he doesn't need the green to cast Bloom. Which I did at regionals.
Wow. Very impressive.
Oh.
Well, you know what may happen here? He may have to cast Natural Balance and he may get a Bance by Lindy before he can even do anything. Draw an island.
Yeah.
Or a Bloom.
Is that a gemstone move?
No, it's an Emerald Charm.
Emerald Charm.
Okay, he has to balance, which means he's going to get advanced in response to the... As soon as the balance of all.
That is unreal.
He wins. Lindy will win this game.
That is absolutely unbelievable. I cannot believe that Lindy...
Is going to win?
He's going to win this game. Unreal. He has an advance in his hand. Are you 100%
certain? 100%
sure. Please do not
right
get my hopes up.
The right side of his hand is an advance.
Unbelievable. A game that looked so over that the crowd thought the game was over. We thought the game was over. Mike Long thought the game was over. I think Mike Long needs to borrow the pen again.
Some bad. Write it all over his forest.
Did Mike Long leave green in his pool?
I'm not letting land.
Okay, so all he has to do is advance him in response to the first spell that he
casts.
Yeah,
it's advance in response to anything.
Which is probably meditate. He better do it, though. That's the question. He still has to do it.
I think he knows. If he doesn't advance him, I will personally crush him.
Jason Gordon did not counterspell. Wait, oh, there it is. He says
there
stop.
Comes.
Here it comes.
Here it comes.
Better.
Happy birthday, Mike.
Good game. Oh!
Mike Long has definite ideas about magic. Mike Long. I prefer Michael Long.
Magic has unlimited potential. It's the most amazing game that's ever been created. The possibilities are limitless. I'm planning on winning it. I'm gonna go into the finals and I'm gonna play my very, very best. As long as my draws come up all right, I should get a decent chance. Future holds, nothing but great things. I mean, Magic is gonna be the biggest thing in the world. Kids everywhere should play this game. It's a great game, it's a smart game. Gets them away from the TV, gets them thinking. It'll be huge.
So it's come down to one final game to decide the championship between Mike Long and Matt Lindy.
Nothing.
Opening draw. Is Infernal Contract, Emerald Charm, Island, Gloom, Vampiric Tutor, and
no
Meditate.
No black mana.
Ooh, not a good draw. His draw, double Cataclysm. That's Sultari Priest, Soul Warden, Warrior Angkor, and two planes. Certainly playable. They both have playable draws.
Go ahead.
And there's an advance. Soul Warden.
Soul Warden.
Hey, honey.
Here you
go.
Clock starts. Long draws. Island. Oh boy. Okay, Long needs black mana more than anything in the world.
He has a power sink, so he can hold off the beating for a while.
So
he's got a power sink this
world. US national championships are decided by like little things.
Like swamps. Draw a swamp.
Nope.
Oh boy.
Was it?
Some good.
On what?
Upkeep draw or whatever.
Oh boy.
Still no black mana for Mike Long.
He's got another priest and a warrior.
So this is all about the race to any of the 14 black or
13
black mana sources Mike Long has in his deck.
Does he draw one? Gloom!
Nope. Gloom!
Oh, the irony of this! Three glooms in hand and no mana to cast them with. He's still got time.
There's not enough pressure on though right now. Is that an aura of silence? We're in good shape. Oh, there's Emerald Charm in Mike Long's hand. He does not have an aura.
Lindy's getting kind of excited here. That takes Long down to 15 life. All right, three turns to draw black mana.
No, Cadaverous
Bloom. Oh my god.
Discards a Gloom.
Some bad. A ban during upkeep.
It doesn't stop Gloom, unfortunately.
I know.
Cast another creature.
No reason to cast anything. He has a disenchant in his hand. He can't kill him. He can't kill him next turn. He has a disenchant in hand.
All right, very true. He should just stay done.
Of
it.
Yeah. City of Brass.
Oh, there's a problem.
One more turn for you, Mike. Now the question is, does he hold back in Vampiric Tutor at the end of the turn? And get, what could he possibly get? Does he have natural balance
in
hand?
Then he gets a banced.
Then he gets a banced. Lindy has armor in hand now. So armor comes down one of those creatures and Long dies immediately.
Mike Long.
If he casts...
is very likely dead.
He has to cast Gloom.
He has to cast Gloom, untap, and hope.
And draw what?
Squander?
Possibly draw. Squander resources? That's but he'd have no mana. He can't do anything with it.
He can kind of do not that much.
Is there any way that Long can mathematically win this game? He doesn't have Lotus Petals.
I have to see his entire hand. I don't know what his entire hand is. Yeah, he has a Bloom. He does not have it. He does not have.
He doesn't have another land, so he can't draw a Scorn of Resources and a land in the next draw phase.
Well. All right, I guess he can. But
probably not going to pull that off. Okay, I don't think that there's any way that Long can win this. Interesting enough, neither player is saying a word here.
So once again, whenever a relative unknown wins a major Magic tournament, it's with White Weenie.
Sort of possibly be if I had a Dark Ritual in my deck. Hammer would be very happy.
I only played two in my Boom deck.
You played two Dark Ritual? Hush.
Lindy's now toying with Long. Yeah, Lindy just said he had Dark Rituals in his Bloom deck.
They're so good. First turn, Gloom.
You suppose those guys are going to be attacking next turn?
I think so.
This guy's looking pensive. Why don't we just put him over here?
Maybe.
He's just gonna hang out.
Okay.
Just put him back here.
Okay.
That over there.
He'll be laying.
Sure.
Ooh, what happened to my Sultari Monk?
I'd like the crowd to take into consideration you can't go crazy with disappointment when Mike Long isn't national champion. Please, no rioting. Leave the chairs where they are. Long's doing the math, but I don't think it's going to get him
anywhere. Can't do anything. There's no cards left.
Matt Lindy wins a quick $25,000.
Nah.
He doesn't even cast. Doesn't even cast Gloom.
Go ahead. I mean, if you want to go on, because you know.
Armor. Mash.
I think he'll forget the priest is there, because that would be unreal.
Verdant Touch, bye-bye.
Bastard.
He doesn't armor.
He didn't armor.
I guess he just knows he can advance during upkeep.
Oh, he does have the power sink, that's true.
Here you go.
Long thinks Tutor. Long says, what? Can I tutor for a Black Lotus?
He's certainly not going to meditate.
Probably not.
Abeyance is so powerful against Bloom.
It is.
It's like it's its biggest friend and its biggest enemy.
Yep. Look at his hand. Disenchant, disenchant, Abeyance. And an Ice Age Plant.
Oh, hush.
Liddy says, I might have an upkeep effect.
You have her tutor during your discard phase? Pay 3 life, I'm at 2. Or I take a point damage and then pay 2 life.
Tutor for Dread of Night, cast it. Oh wait, he doesn't have that.
That's true.
Whoops.
Dread of Night would get disenchanted though.
What? It would still kill all three creatures.
It would still kill all the creatures.
And Lindy has no more creatures in his hand.
That's very true. He does have a warrior right core.
In fact, if Long had 3 Dread of Nights this game instead of 3 Glooms, I think he would probably win.
I know what you got by that.
It's very possible. But there's another game where we aren't sure what would have happened if he had.
I still think Dreadanite's better. Imagine that. Those three glooms are three Dreadanites.
Untap.
Untap.
Upkeep.
Upkeep. Draw.
What is he doing?
Why is he not advancing right
now? Why is he
right
not
now?
Advancing him?
Point for black, point for green, yep. Last wanderer.
Advance in response?
Just advance him already. Advance him before something horrid happens.
Nothing horrid can happen.
I know, but...
He can't even natural balance.
I would advance him 20 minutes ago.
Blue.
It's not a good deal here, Mike.
Wander. Wander. Meditate.
Bane, you're fine.
Sure.
Good game. Disenchant the score on a resource.
Disenchant square.
Now kick me in the nuts.
Oh, wow.
That's about it. Oh, and there's the handshake we've all been waiting for.
Matt Lindy is national champion.
Matt Lindy is national champion.
Was I?
Join the U.S. team as they travel to Seattle, Washington to compete in the 1998 World Championships. Watch all the action on ESPN2. Matt Lindy collects $25,000 as the winner of the 1998 U.S. Nationals. Second place in a check for $15,000 goes to Mike Long.
Ladies and gentlemen, the 1998 U.S. National Team. Congratulations, gentlemen.
This is a great feeling for me. I got three great team members. I mean, I couldn't be more excited going into World Championships.
I don't know. I don't think it's really set in yet. I mean, it's a lot to take in.
We just want to thank all our teammates and the people that worked together. You know, you can see everyone here had strong community.
The accomplishment that we have here is not just a reflection of our own work. It's the work of everyone that we've played with in the last couple years. You know, it takes a lot for just one person to get to this level.
We are going to be prepared and
we got teams.
We're going to back it up. It's one thing to talk it, we're going to walk it.